Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Brains Through Time, A Natural History of Vertebrates by Georg F. Striedter and R. Glenn Northcutt. Read by Tom Perkins. Publisher's note, this audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface. For a professor to write a book with one of his PhD students 20 years after said student left the lab is highly unusual. It suggests a complicated backstory. Indeed, the idea for this book was hatched a long, long time ago. Here is what Glenn, the senior author, wrote in 1996 in his initial proposal to publishers. The evolution of vertebrate brains and the behaviors they subserved can best be understood in the broader context of vertebrate evolution. In order to understand why brains exhibit different patterns of organization among existing vertebrates, it is first necessary to understand the origin and subsequent radiation of each vertebrate group. This, in turn, necessitates some understanding of the physical and biological worlds in which these events took place. When vertebrate diversity is viewed in this context, it becomes apparent that the origin of each vertebrate group was based on a few key innovations that allowed an ancestral population to exploit the environment in a novel way. Subsequent evolution of that population was channeled, both facilitated and constrained, by these innovations. Once the key innovations of a particular group are identified, it is possible to see how brains were modified and how they reflected and subserved these innovations. While this approach is widely used in most areas of biological research, neurobiology is a notable exception. Most neurobiological research is model-driven and results in detailed data that are frequently unintelligible and uninteresting to most integrative and organismal biologists. This book is an attempt to bring neurobiology within the purview of the wider integrative biological audience and at the same time to demonstrate the strengths of a comparative approach to the neurobiological community. This proposal was met with great excitement by Glenn's students and friends, and it resulted in a book contract. However, execution of the plan was far more challenging than expected. As Glenn began to write, the number of planned pages swelled, and many pages filled with jargon and a slew of anatomical details. The number of planned figures also grew, as Glenn developed plans to illustrate the internal organization of many different vertebrate brains, their cranial nerves, and all the major sense organs, not to mention their phylogenetic relationships and ecological contexts. Long fragments of two chapters gradually emerged, but Glenn became increasingly concerned about losing his audience. Who would want to read this book? Who would be able to absorb all of the included detail? As the concerns grew, the book project languished. When Glenn retired in the summer of 2014, Glenn's friends urged him to pick the project up again. Especially adamant were some of Glenn's former students, among them Georg. Toward the end of 2014, over lunch in San Diego, Georg offered to help in any way he could. Having just finished the writing of an introductory textbook on neurobiology, Georg was also casting about for a new, big project. By the end of lunch, a plan was hatched for Georg to join the project as junior partner, using his book writing skills to complement Glenn's deep knowledge of vertebrate brains, both extant and extinct. Georg's knowledge of avian and mammalian nervous systems would also nicely complement Glenn's expertise on piscine, amphibian, and reptilian brains. As first author, Georg would do the writing and generate most of the figures, but both authors plan to meet regularly to harmonize their vision, hatch specific plans, and discuss revisions to the figures and text. 4 years and more than a dozen face-to-face meetings later, the book is here. Reflecting on the process now, the metaphor of two people paddling a canoe, illustrated in Figure P1, seems apt. Georg was sitting in the front, paddling furiously and alert to diverse obstacles and possible paths. Glenn was in the back, steering in more subtle ways and delivering occasional power strokes. Together, they managed to get through unharmed and without major fights. More importantly, they took a path that neither one of them alone would have been able to pursue. Nor was the path entirely predictable. In several cases, both authors abandoned some of their own long-standing views. Those moments were especially thrilling, perhaps because they were risky. 1. Reconstructing History, Aims and Methodology. There is one purpose to life, and one only: to bear witness to and understand as much as possible of the complexity of the world, its beauty, its mysteries, its riddles. The more you understand, the more you look, the greater is your enjoyment of life and your sense of peace. Anne Rice, Servant of the Bones, 1996, page 135. It is interesting to contemplate a tangled bank, clothed with many plants of many kinds, with birds singing on the bushes, with various insects flitting about, and with worms crawling through the damp earth, and to reflect that these elaborately constructed forms, so different from each other and dependent upon each other in so complex a manner, have all been produced by laws acting around us. There is grandeur in this view of life. Charles Darwin, The Origin of Species, 6th edition, 1872, pages 444 to 445. Separated by more than 100 years, by the Atlantic Ocean, and by very different lines of work, Anne Rice and Charles Darwin both described the pleasure that can come from observing nature's complexity. One can, of course, appreciate nature without giving it much thought, but Rice and Darwin were describing a deeper sense of joy, one that comes from not just looking at nature, but from understanding how its diverse elements are connected to one another and to us. This deeper sense of enjoyment lies at the heart of natural history and is what we hope to facilitate. But how does one go from merely looking at nature to understanding it? Two main approaches have been recognized. One is to collect a large number of observations in various places under a variety of different conditions, and then to look for meaningful patterns in the collected data. This comparative approach can suggest hypotheses that might explain the discovered pattern. These hypotheses can then be tested using the second complementary approach, which is to manipulate nature in highly specific ways and then observe whether the manipulations have the expected effects, that is, the experimental method. The crucial difference is that the comparative method relies on naturally occurring variation, whereas the experimental method creates artificial variation that can be tightly controlled. Although the experimental method is often celebrated as the key to scientific success, the comparative approach has played a crucial role in most scientific fields. In the following sections, we illustrate this role first in several non-biological domains and then within biology. Our aim is not to elevate comparative approaches over experimental ones, but to highlight the utility of comparative research, especially in disciplines that are not very amenable to experimentation. This sampling of comparative research in diverse disciplines also allows us to introduce a few concepts that are important for later chapters, such as the idea that a layer of rock can be dated to a specific period in the Earth's history, that continental plates move slowly across the globe, and that the history of species long extinct can be reconstructed from present-day observations. 1.1. Comparative approaches outside of biology. Comparative approaches are used in virtually all fields of academic inquiry, ranging from literature and art to social sciences and economics. For our purposes, it is most instructive to examine how comparative research has advanced our knowledge in some of the physical sciences, notably astrophysics, chemistry, and geology. 1.1.1. Stellar evolution. When you look up at the sky on a clear moonless night, you may see a few thousand stars. It can be fun and awe-inspiring, especially if you are in the mountains or the desert, but most of us will not see much of a pattern in those stars. You might notice that some are brighter than others, that they vary slightly in color, and that they are more common in some parts of the sky, for instance, the Milky Way. You might even recognize some of the constellations you learned about, but the pattern still appears largely random. Not so for astronomers. Over many years, they diligently collected enormous amounts of data on the position, brightness, luminance, and color of the stars, and then looked for patterns. A major breakthrough came in 1911 to 1913, when Enyar Hertzsprung and Henry N. Russell plotted luminance versus color for hundreds of stars in the same general region of space, which meant that the included stars were likely similar in age and chemical composition. The resulting plot, now called the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, revealed that roughly 90% of all the data points cluster along the diagonal, forming what astronomers call the main sequence, figure 1.1. A second cluster forms a horizontal branch which diverges from the main sequence toward the right side of the diagram. A few additional data points aggregate in the diagram's top right corner, and a few are found near the bottom left. How should one explain this surprisingly heterogeneous, non-random distribution of stars in the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram? The answer is that the observed pattern reflects the dynamics of stellar evolution. Astronomers had suspected since the 1880s that stars do not exist for all eternity, but, instead, are born from the contraction of cosmic dust clouds and die when they shrink dramatically and cease to give off light. As a star goes through its life cycle, it changes in brightness and in temperature, that is, color. The importance of the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram lay in its implication that stars spend most of their life cycle in an equilibrium state that places them along the main sequence. Combining these data with additional insights from experimental studies and theoretical considerations, astronomers hypothesized that, during their time on the main sequence, stars are burning hydrogen in their core and remain relatively constant in size. When the hydrogen fuel runs out, the stars begin to burn helium in their core. At that point, they move off the main sequence along the horizontal branch or nearby paths and swell until they become giants or, depending on their initial mass, supergiants. Eventually, every star becomes completely depleted of fuel and begins to shrink, collapsing into itself. Such depleted stars then become white dwarfs, or if they had been supergiants, black holes. The Hertzsprung-Russell diagram was not, in and of itself, sufficient to generate all this information about stellar evolution, but it was a major factor, for example, in the realization that stars heat up and expand before they cool and shrink. It also influenced Arthur Eddington's theory about what happens inside stars and how this changes over time. Remarkably, these advances in astronomy occurred long before scientists fully understood the chain reactions that happen at the extremely high pressures and temperatures inside a stellar core. That is, they predated our understanding of thermonuclear fusion, which flourished only in the 1940s and 1950s. The new knowledge did force some revision of the original ideas about stellar evolution, but the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram is still widely taught and often used to illustrate the developmental trajectories of individual stars. 1.1.2, the periodic table. Chemists labored for many years to identify the 94 different elements of which the natural world is built, as well as a few that can be synthesized. As scientists learned about the characteristics of these elements, they noticed both similarities and differences. Early attempts to make sense of this pattern included the recognition that similar elements sometimes come in groups of three, triads, that elemental properties tend to covary with atomic weight, and that some properties recur at regular intervals, that is, periodically, along a series of increasing atomic weights. The most successful attempt to recognize a meaningful pattern in the available data was that of Mendeleev, who grouped similar elements by arranging them in columns and rows, as shown in Figure 1.2. This effort allowed him to identify some mistakes in the data of the time and, more importantly, to predict the existence of several elements that had not yet been identified. Mendeleev's original periodic table had to be amended in light of subsequent discoveries, such as the identification of noble gases, but his insights were based on a comparative approach and clearly drove the field of chemistry forward. The pattern that Mendeleev identified is not inherently historical, but most chemical elements do have a history. The discovery of this fact owes much to a number of scientists who had collected data on the relative abundance of the various elements. They noticed that hydrogen is by far the most abundant element in the universe, with helium a distant second. All of the other heavier elements are relatively rare. Moreover, plotting an element's abundance against its atomic number revealed a distinct sawtooth pattern, with the even-numbered elements being more abundant than their odd-numbered neighbors, Figure 1.2. Combined with other knowledge, these relative abundance curves suggested that most elements were not generated at the time of the Big Bang, but rather are generated inside stars as they proceed through their life cycle. The fusion of two hydrogen nuclei inside a star generates helium. Subsequently, the fusion of helium nuclei with one another and the fusion of their fusion products in various combinations produces the other elements with even atomic numbers. Fusing some of them with hydrogen atoms creates the odd-numbered elements, but they are less commonly formed and less stable. Hence, the bias toward even-numbered elements, a.k.a. the Otto-Harkins rule. Of course, stellar nucleosynthesis is more complex than we describe, but the comparative approach clearly helped to advance our understanding of how chemical elements are born. We also think that it is beautiful and grand, in Rice's and Darwin's sense, to realize that most of the elements that sustain life on Earth originated in the stars. Since roughly 40 tons of cosmic dust enter our atmosphere each day, and many of its elements end up inside our bodies, we heartily assent to Joni Mitchell's lyrics that we are stardust. 1.1.3 Geological Strata. Gazing at the walls of a steep canyon or a rocky outcrop, it becomes apparent that the Earth's crust forms a series of layers, strata, that differ in their chemical composition. But what does this geological stratification mean? Nicholas Steno, a Catholic priest working for the Medici family in the late 1600s, thought about this problem and realized that the layers were most likely formed by the deposition of new layers on top of older ones, usually as sediment on the bottom of a body of water. He further realized that the layers of rock and soil must have been horizontal when they first formed, but could be tilted or otherwise distorted by subsequent processes. Most importantly, Steno concluded that, at any given location, the upper strata must always be younger than the deeper ones. Steno's insights were extended in the 1790s by William Smith, a British geologist, who noticed that the ordering of the geological strata was consistent from place to place, at least within large parts of England. Being an avid fossil collector, Smith also realized that each layer contained a unique set of fossils, such that he could discriminate geologically similar layers by their fossil content. Combining this insight with Steno's principle of superposition, Smith inferred that the fossils in the upper layers must be younger than those in the lower strata. Similar ideas had been developed independently, convergently, by Georges Cuvier and Alexandre Brongniart in France around the same time. Curiously, none of these authors interpreted the succession of different fossils in the geological strata as evidence of evolution. Cuvier and Brongniart thought the changes were due to local ecological catastrophes, followed by migrations of new species into the formerly devastated areas, and Smith was not very interested in theoretical ideas at all. He was more interested in using his knowledge to find coal deposits or nutrient-rich soil. Indeed, the scientific understanding of geological stratification has frequently helped explorers discover coal, oil, and diverse minerals. As geologists identified more and more geological strata, they grouped adjacent strata into a hierarchical arrangement of stages, series, systems, and erythems. Figure 1.3. Initially, the ages of the various layers could only be determined relative to one another using Steno's principle of superposition. However, the development of carbon dating and various other techniques eventually made it possible to assign specific chronological dates to many of the layer boundaries. As a result, it is now possible to think of individual geological stages, series, systems, and erythems as chronological ages, epochs, periods, and eras, respectively. The Mesozoic era, for example, lasted from 252 to 66 million years ago, and the Jurassic period lasted from 201 to 145 years before the present, figure 1.3. This absolute dating of geological strata is important because it allows us to specify when a particular species first appeared in the fossil record, and if the species became extinct, when it disappeared from that record. Since the fossil record is notoriously incomplete, a species might have existed earlier than the record suggests, and it might well have persisted longer. However, the dated fossils give us minimum estimates for both the first appearance of a species and its longevity. As we discuss shortly, these estimates are very useful for dating the divergence of various groups of animals from one another. 1.1.4 Plate Tectonics. The comparative approach further advanced geology by helping to reveal that the Earth's continents have slowly moved across the globe. One of the first steps in this major discovery was the realization that the western coastline of Africa runs roughly parallel with the eastern coastline of South America. The fit of these continental boundaries is even better when one includes the shallow seas around the continents, that is, the continental shelves, figure 1.4. This fit of the continental boundaries came to the attention of Alfred Wegener, who cleverly combined it with the knowledge that surprisingly similar fossils were found on opposite sides of the Atlantic. In 1912, Wegener proposed that the continents of today had once been assembled into a giant supercontinent, which he called Pangaea. The flip side of this argument was Wegener's continental drift hypothesis, according to which Pangaea broke up when its component continents drifted apart. Unfortunately, the mechanism that Wegener proposed to explain why the continents would move as he proposed was widely deemed implausible and, as a result, his theory was rarely taken seriously. Despite this setback, evidence in favor of continental movements continued to accumulate. Especially important was the discovery that earthquakes and other seismic events were concentrated in specific lines across the globe, figure 1.4, which we now recognize as defining the edges of continental plates. Additional evidence came from paleomagnetic studies, which are based on the fact that the magnetic particles in rocks reflect the orientation of the Earth's magnetic field at the time and place where the rock was formed. Such studies have shown that the ocean floor adjacent to some of the continental plate boundaries exhibits bands of alternating magnetic polarity that run parallel to the plate boundaries. Given that the Earth's magnetic polarity is thought to reverse every few thousand years, these alternating bands suggest that new rock is created at those plate boundaries by molten rock that ascends from deep within the Earth and fills the widening gaps between the continental plates. Additional evidence came from studies that measured the magnetic field in various rock strata on a specific continent and used these data to estimate the location of the Earth's magnetic poles over millions of years. Such studies showed that the Earth's magnetic poles appear to have moved much more than one would expect from a slight wobbling of the Earth's rotational axis, figure 1.4. The simplest explanation for this observation is that it is not, in fact, the poles that wandered, but the continents. Geologists later combined these diverse forms of evidence with a more plausible mechanism for continental movements, namely a set of convection currents beneath the Earth's crust that can force the continents apart or crash them into one another. These efforts resulted in the theory of plate tectonics, which is now widely accepted. Importantly, for our purposes, geologists can use the apparent polar wander paths as well as other forms of evidence to estimate the location of the various continental plates during the various periods of the Earth's history. The estimates get more uncertain the further back one goes. But for the period during which vertebrates emerged and thrived, that is, after the Cambrian, those estimates are reasonably robust. They indicate, for example, that Pangaea was assembled roughly 335 million years ago and started to break apart 160 million years later. 1.2. The comparative method in biology. Comparative approaches have contributed substantially to many different areas of biology. For example, Alexander von Humboldt at the beginning of the 19th century collected vast amounts of information on the geographical distribution of plants and animals, which eventually led him to realize that particular types of species occur in predictable combinations across the globe. With this insight, he invented the concept of ecological zones and, one might say, ecology in general. Other biologists were preoccupied with arranging the multitude of plant and animal species according to some kind of logical framework. First came the notion of arranging species along a linear scale, but Darwin and others later argued that the underlying pattern was actually a huge family tree. Subsequent generations of biologists focused on how one might reconstruct this tree of life. They also wanted to know how best to trace the evolution of individual traits and how to test hypotheses about adaptation and constraint. In the following, we discuss all these subjects in turn. 1.2.1. Scale of nature versus family tree. Starting at least with Aristotle, scientists have tried to order the different types of animals and plants along a linear scale called scala naturae, Latin for scale of nature. The metric for this scale is usually the similarity between a given species and Homo sapiens, such that the animals most similar to us are placed on the highest rungs, while species progressively more different from us are assigned to successively lower positions along the scale. A major problem with this view is that similarity to humans is a highly multidimensional measure, and different dimensions yield different species rankings. For example, rankings based on presumed intelligence might place dolphins high on the scale, while rankings based on mode of locomotion elevate the flightless birds, for instance, kiwis and ostriches, far above dolphins and other aquatic mammals. Regardless of the measure used, adherents of the scala naturae view tend to equate increases in similarity to humans with evolutionary progress. Biologists in the second half of the 19th century sought alternative ways to make sense of species similarities and differences. The most successful effort was that of Charles Darwin, who realized in the mid-1800s that the connections between species formed not a scale, but a family tree, a genealogy. In the only figure in his Origin of Species, Darwin illustrated how two species can diverge over the course of many, many generations into multiple distinct populations and eventually into several new species. Figure 1.5. This schema is clearly incompatible with the concept of scala naturae. After all, could you rank your own extended family members along a simple linear scale? Therefore, Darwin described the genealogy of species not as a scale, but as a tree of life. In one of his notebooks, he even called it a coral of life, because, as in healthy corals, only the tips are currently alive. Although Darwin remained conflicted about the relationship between evolution and progress, he was quite clear that any such progress could be reversed, and in any case, evolution did not follow a single linear path. Although Darwin's ideas became widely accepted, scala naturae thinking remains widespread. Even expert neurobiologists often resurrect it in the form of a phylogenetic scale. For example, they often draw phylogenetic trees that look like conifers, that is, fir trees, with humans perched on top and all the lower branches neatly pruned. Other diagrams may look more deeply branched, that is, bush-like, but all the living species are arranged in series from low to high with humans at the top, figure 1.6. As further evidence that the scala naturae concept lives on, the official Guide for the Care and Use of Laboratory Animals discusses replacing animals, such as vertebrates, with animals that are lower on the phylogenetic scale. According to the National Academy of Sciences, therefore, an institutional animal care and use committee may be compelled to use the fallacious concept of a phylogenetic scale when deciding whether to approve a research proposal. Scala naturae thinking may also manifest in phylogenetic diagrams that seem, at first glance, to contain no explicit scale. Consider, for example, the top diagram in Figure 1.7. This cladogram depicts the evolutionary branching order of the hypothetical taxonomic groups listed across the top, letters A through F. Taxon E is more closely related to taxon F than any of the other taxa. D is more closely related to E plus F than to any other taxa, and so on. Importantly, taxa A through F are arranged in an orderly sequence from left to right, creating the impression that taxa A, B, C, D, E, and F form a phylogenetic scale, at least for people from cultures in which writing is read from left to right. This impression vanishes, however, when the branches are displayed in fully equivalent but graphically different ways. As shown in Figure 1.7, the underlying phylogenetic relationships remain the same when the lines are graphically rotated around one or more of the branch points, aka nodes, even though the apparent sequence, for instance from left to right, is rearranged. Similarly, the original phylogenetic scale disappears when some taxonomic groups are deleted from the diagram while others are expanded. Bottom diagram of Figure 1.7. Thus, the letters at the top of the cladogram do not constitute a phylogenetic sequence, let alone a scale. Instead, phylogenetic sequences flow from the bottom of each cladogram toward the top, tracing out multiple diverging trajectories. Moreover, all cladograms are biased in the sense that they represent only a subset of all species. Comparative biologists often focus on a specific subset of species because they are interested in following the evolution of a specific lineage. Often, this is our own hominid phylogeny. As O'Hara has pointed out, goldfish would likely focus on a different set of species and tell a very different story, and they would illustrate it with a cladogram that places goldfish on the right and includes far more ray-finned fishes than mammals. That said, we freely acknowledge that the organization of our book also serves an anthropocentric storyline. In our view, there is nothing inherently wrong with emphasizing a particular set of evolutionary transformations, as long as one acknowledges that similar transformations may have occurred in other lineages. 1.2.2. Reconstructing phylogenies. Darwin's insight that species are connected to one another through their genealogy was slow to change the practice of species classification, but change did come eventually. Historically, taxonomic classifications had been based on the similarity between species, with the most similar species grouped together into a genus, the most similar genera grouped into families, similar families into orders, etc. This phonetic approach to classification worked well for many years, but had the same fundamental flaw as the scala naturae view, namely that emphasizing different forms of similarity produced different classifications. Taxonomists tried to solve this problem by quantifying the similarity between species and then subjecting the data to hierarchical clustering algorithms. But the results still depended heavily on the types of similarities that were considered and the algorithms that were used for clustering. In contrast, scientists who took Darwin's discovery to heart argued that species classifications should be based solely on genealogy rather than similarity. Just as your brother might be more similar to one of your cousins than to you, So a species might be quite different from its sister species, yet similar to a more distant relative, at least in some respects. But if similarity is not a reliable indicator of phylogenetic relationship, how can scientists infer the phylogenetic relationships between species without having a time machine? 1.2.2.1 Phylogenetic Systematics. The solution to this quandary was articulated most clearly and forcefully by the German entomologist Willy Hennig. He argued that the key to reconstructing phylogeny is to identify features, aka characters, that arose just once in some ancestral species and were then inherited by the descendant species. In contrast, characters that arose multiple times in diverse lineages are unhelpful, if not downright misleading, when it comes to reconstructing phylogenetic relationships. Characters that evolved long before the last common ancestor of the species being examined also offer no real clue about the species' relationships. To illustrate the latter point, consider how you might determine the phylogenetic relationships between lampreys, a group of eel-shaped jawless vertebrates, sharks, and cows. At first, you might think that lampreys and sharks must be more closely related to one another than they are to cows, because both have gills, swim in water, and have a cartilaginous rather than bony skeleton. However, all of these characters are also found in the nearest invertebrate relatives of all vertebrates, tunicates and amphioxus, see chapter 2, which means that they probably evolved long before the three taxa diverged from one another. In contrast, jaws and paired appendages are found in sharks and cows and other nathostomes, but not in lampreys or any invertebrates that are closely related to vertebrates, that is, outgroups to vertebrates. Thus, jaws and paired appendages are shared derived characters, aka synapomorphies, for sharks and cows. According to Hennig and his followers, who came to be known as cladists, this means that they support the hypothesis that cows and sharks are more closely related to one another than they are to lampreys. One potential problem for Hennig's cladistic approach is that some shared derived characters might be lost in some descendants of the ancestor in which they first emerged. For example, dolphins and other toothed whales have lost the body hair that presumably evolved in the last common ancestor of all mammals. See chapter 6. This problem can be easily avoided, however, if enough other mammals are included in the analysis, because then it becomes abundantly clear that having body hair is the primitive condition for mammals. A more serious problem is that an attribute that had been suspected of being a shared derived character for some lineage might actually have evolved independently in several different lineages. The best way to avoid such errors is to consider many different characters when reconstructing any phylogeny. When this is done, the preponderance of characters will frequently provide strong support for a specific phylogeny, or small group of very similar phylogenies, so that the incongruent, repeatedly evolved features can be identified with ease. For instance, character number 8 in figure 1.8. Historically, systematists used mainly morphological characters to build phylogenies, but in the 1980s they increasingly began to use molecular data. The early attempts at molecular phylogenetics were problematic because they relied on overall similarity measures derived from DNA-DNA hybridization rather than specific genomic characters. Even studies that looked at variation in specific genes provided uncertain variable results because different genes evolve at different rates in different lineages, because genes were lost or duplicated differentially between the studied lineages, that is, incomplete lineage sorting, for instance, and because most studies examined a small number of species. Over the years, however, the accumulation of vast amounts of comparative molecular data, as well as major improvements in analytical techniques, have mitigated these concerns. As a result, many of the phylogenies we have relied on in this book are based on the analysis of dozens, if not thousands, of genes, as well as non-coding DNA sequences. these phylogenies are often consistent with the comparative morphological data, and some of the best phylogenies are based on both molecular and morphological data. An important exception to this rule is that the phylogenies of extinct species must, for obvious reasons, rely on morphological data alone. That said, fossil-based phylogenies also continued to improve as more specimens have come to light, and the analysis techniques became more powerful. The new generation of phylogenetic analyses has supported many traditional ideas about species relationships, but it has also spawned some major revisions. Those revisions have forced biologists to come up with new names for some taxonomic groups and to abandon other names. In particular, modern biologists have tended to discard old names that refer to paraphyletic groups defined as taxonomic groupings that include some but not all descendants of their last common ancestor. For example, the term reptiles specifically excludes birds, even though birds are more closely related to crocodilians than to any other living vertebrates. Figure 1.9. Instead, modern biologists prefer taxonomic names that refer to monophyletic groups, defined as all the descendants of a common ancestor, as well as that ancestor itself. Thus, reptiles and birds, flying reptiles, together form a monophyletic group that we call the sauropsids. Figure 1.9. Cladists also discourage names that refer to polyphyletic groups, which are defined by similarities that evolved independently. For example, the term warm-blooded vertebrates refers to birds and mammals because these are the only major extant, that is, living, groups of vertebrates capable of generating their own body heat. See Chapter 6. But birds and mammals do not share a common ancestor that is not also shared by numerous cold-blooded reptiles. Therefore, the term does not reflect phylogenetic relatedness and should be avoided. We generally concur with these recommendations, but plead guilty to sometimes using the old established names when their meaning is clear. Extinct species are frequently included in phylogenetic analyses and depicted in cladograms, where they are often marked with a cross to signify their extinction. When this is done, it is common practice to refer to the monophyletic group that includes all the extant members of a lineage as the crown group of that lineage, figure 1.9. The closest extinct relatives of that crown group are called the stem groups for that lineage. 1.2.2.2, time trees. The phylogenetic diagrams produced by cladists, that is, cladograms, depict the branching order of the investigated species, but they usually do not contain an absolute time scale. To provide estimates of species divergence times, fossil specimens of a known age, for instance from a carbon-dated layer of rock, are certainly useful. However, one can never know whether a given fossil is an ancestor of a specific group of living species or merely a side branch that became extinct. Nonetheless, it is usually possible to assign a fossil specimen to a specific lineage, which then establishes the lineage's minimum age. Because the fossil record is generally incomplete, all lineages have a ghost lineage component that goes back beyond the known fossil record. As a result of this limitation, even carefully selected fossils can establish only the minimum divergence time between two or more lineages. An important step toward resolving this problem was taken when comparative molecular biologists realized that some gene and protein sequences have changed at relatively constant rates over evolutionary time. If the rate of this molecular clock is known, then it should be possible to determine how long ago the genes and proteins in different species diverged from one another. This divergence time, in turn, ought to reflect the divergence time between the species themselves. Although this idea was fascinating, it soon became apparent that the rate of evolutionary change is different for different genes and proteins. It also varies between lineages, if only because species often differ substantially in generation time. To address these issues, some researchers compute average rates of change across multiple genes and species. But this approach leads to very uncertain estimates. A more productive approach has been to develop relaxed clock models that explicitly allow for unequal rates of molecular evolution. To make these models work, researchers use strategically selected fossils to calibrate the molecular clocks in multiple lineages. Thus, molecular and fossil data are combined to generate time trees, figure 1.10, that illustrate both phylogenetic relationships and absolute divergence times. The divergence estimates produced in these analyses are usually older than those produced by purely morphological fossil studies, but this is not surprising given the universal presence of ghost lineages. Only when the molecular data suggest that divergence times are much, much older than the oldest fossils in those lineages do heated controversies ensue. This is not the case for most of the lineages we discuss in this book. 1.2.3 Character Reconstruction and Homology. Once a well-supported, robust phylogeny has been obtained, it becomes possible to reconstruct the evolutionary history of individual characters within that phylogeny. Those characters might be a stretch of DNA, a specific gene, a protein, a morphological structure, a physiological process, or even a species' typical behavior. Regardless of the type of character one is examining, the first step in character reconstruction is to map the distribution of the character across the extant species in the phylogenetic tree, that is, the tips of the cladogram, or time tree. Next, one must reconstruct at which nodes in the phylogeny the character was present and where it was not. This reconstruction of conditions at the nodes requires testing various possibilities and then selecting the most parsimonious scenario, which is defined as the scenario requiring the smallest number of evolutionary transformations, gains or losses, of the character. Figure 1.11. Often this kind of character reconstruction reveals that the character in question is confined to a monophyletic group of species, meaning that it arose with the origin of that group and was retained in most of its descendants, but does not appear in other portions of the cladogram. In such cases, the character is said to be homologous among the members of this group. It is also a shared derived character for that group. In other instances, however, parsimony analysis will indicate that the character in question evolved more than once in disparate lineages. In that case, the independently evolved characters are not homologous to one another. Although the concept of homology is much maligned and often misunderstood, in the context of phylogenetic systematics and parsimony analysis, its definition is clear. For example, camera-type eyes, that is, eyes with a single lens, evolved independently in vertebrates and cephalopods, octopus and squid, because it would be much less parsimonious to argue that such eyes were lost repeatedly in all the intervening lineages. Figure 1.11. Therefore, the eyes in these two lineages are not homologous to one another, even though they are remarkably similar. Vertebrate and cephalopod eyes are also not homologous to the compound eyes of insects and other arthropods, which are structurally quite different from camera eyes. For instance, they contain thousands of separate lenses. This is interesting because eye development in both insects and vertebrates requires the expression of PAX6, which is found in all metazoan animals and therefore is homologous among them. Thus, we here have a case of non-homologous structures requiring the expression of homologous genes. Such instances are often cited as examples of deep homology, but the morphological structures are nonetheless not really homologous. Instead, the most parsimonious conclusion is that the homologous genes were recruited independently in separate lineages to build non-homologous structures. Indeed, it is difficult to imagine how novel morphological structures could arise in evolution if they did not involve the activation of at least some pre-existing ancestral genes. PAX6, for example, may have been recruited into the variety of master regulator roles because it has two independent DNA binding domains which allow it to control an unusually broad spectrum of target genes. Most characters vary only in relatively minor ways once they have evolved in a particular lineage, which means that they can easily be recognized as the same character in different species. The main olfactory bulb, for example, is readily identifiable in virtually all vertebrates, though it was lost in the toothed whales, because it is remarkably conserved in its position within the brain, in its connection with the olfactory epithelium, and in its histological structure. In contrast, some other characters vary substantially across the members of the lineage in which the character is found. For example, some of the jaw bones in jawed fishes are homologous to the middle ear bones of mammals, meaning that they are considered the same character, but they have clearly changed their structure, position, and function. See chapters 5 and 6. Such cases of transformational homology are fascinating because they tend to be associated with major changes in the behavior and ecology of a species, but they are often controversial precisely because their differences raise doubts about whether they should really be considered the same character. Some of these debates are inevitable, but they can be minimized by clearly defining the characters that one is discussing. In the case of eye evolution, it is important to be clear whether one is talking about the PAX6 gene or eyes, that is, the complex morphological structures. Similarly, one can say that paired appendages are homologous across all jawed vertebrates, while also acknowledging that legs are an innovation of tetrapods and wings have evolved independently as novel characters in birds and bats. Systematists sometimes solve this issue by distinguishing between characters and character states, with legs and wings being different states of the paired appendage character. This terminology can help resolve debates about uncertain homologies insofar as researchers may agree that a particular character is homologous between two or more taxa, even as they disagree about variations in character states. In this book, however, we avoid the term character state. Instead, we strive always to be clear about which character is being considered, where it fits in the hierarchy of biological characters, and how it changed across phylogeny. To reiterate, we define homologous characters as those that are most parsimoniously interpreted as having a continuous history that can be traced back to a single origin in a common ancestral species. Thus, we explicitly exclude characters that evolved independently in two or more lineages, no matter how similar those characters may be. This view is grounded in the theory and practice of phylogenetic systematics. It differs from the view of some other authors who have defined homologous characters as those that share some essential similarity, which then becomes necessary and sufficient for the identification of characters as homologs. Often these essential similarities are given special standing because they relate to developmental mechanisms, such as similarities in the underlying gene networks, embryonic origins, or both. Other essential criteria may include neuronal connections or a character's position within a general morphological framework. Indeed, these features are often remarkably conserved across phylogeny and very useful for identifying potential homologs. However, in our view, all characters, at any level of organization or stage of development, are capable of changing in some subset of their attributes without necessarily forfeiting their homology. Conversely, it is possible for non-homologous characters to arise through similar developmental mechanisms, to exhibit similar connections to other characters, or to occupy similar positions in a topological framework. If those similarities arose independently in more than one lineage, then they are not homologous. 1.2.4 The Evolution of Development. Traditionally, comparative biologists have compared almost exclusively the characters of adult organisms, and they reconstructed their evolutionary history as if one adult character had transformed directly into another. However, an adult animal never produces another adult organism directly, at least not among most animals. Instead, they produce a zygote, which then develops into the adult form of the next generation. Figure 1.12. As Walter Garstang put it in 1922, The real phylogeny of metazoa, multicellular animals, has never been a direct succession of adult forms, but a succession of ontogenies or life cycles. From this perspective, evolutionary change is not accomplished by direct modifications of an adult character, but by changes in the character's developmental trajectory, in its ontogeny. To quote Garstang again, ontogeny does not recapitulate phylogeny, it creates it. If this is true, then comparative biologists should be encouraged to compare not only adult forms, but also entire developmental pathways, that is, ontogenies. Some comparative biologists had long been interested in the evolution of development, but most of their attention had been focused on the idea that ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny. Specifically, they usually assumed that organisms in their development pass through the adult stages of their successive ancestors, which would allow researchers to elucidate phylogenetic relationships by studying ontogenetic sequences. This recapitulation theory is based on the idea that evolution modifies ontogenies only by adding stages to their end, extending development beyond the adult stages of the immediate ancestor. Figure 1.12. This assumption has always been problematic because it implies that ontogenies would become deleteriously long over evolutionary time, unless some developmental stages were compressed or deleted. Moreover, the recapitulation theory disregarded plenty of evidence for larval adaptations that probably never existed in any adult form. For example, chickens develop an egg tooth on top of their beak just before they hatch. This tooth helps them escape from the eggshell, but it probably never existed in any adult ancestors of birds. More recent comparative embryological studies have further clarified that the evolutionary addition of stages to the end of ancestral ontogenies, that is, terminal addition, is by no means the principal form of evolutionary changes in development. Consider, for example, the development and evolution of the lateral line system, which consists of mechanosensory and electrosensory cells on or just below the body surface of most aquatic vertebrates. These sensory cells can detect mechanical and weak electrical stimuli that are transmitted through the water surrounding the animal. See Chapter 2. A parsimony analysis reveals that the primitive developmental pathway for this sensory system includes a series of 8 stages, figure 1.12. During the last 2 stages of this sequence, the sensory receptor primordia sink deeper into the skin and become enclosed in a series of canals, the lateral line canals. Importantly, the comparative analysis also showed that this developmental sequence is cut short in aquatic salamanders and leptocerinid lungfishes, such that their lateral line receptor cells remain at the body's surface, not enclosed by a canal. These terminal deletions clearly falsify the recapitulation theory. Even more interesting is that those salamanders and lungfishes have similar terminal deletions in the ontogenies of many different characters, which means that these animals, in numerous respects, look like the juveniles of their most likely ancestors. We return to this phenomenon of pedomorphosis in Chapter 4. In addition to deleting stages from the end of a developmental sequence, evolution frequently alters the trajectory of ancestral ontogenies before they reach their ancestral endpoint. One example of such a divergence between primitive and derived ontogenies is provided by the evolution of the rostral organ in coelacanths. This unique set of electrosensory lateral line canals on the dorsal snout of coelacanths is probably used to detect potential prey at close range. It is clearly homologous to part of the lateral line system in other fishes, but its developmental pathway must have diverged from the ancestral developmental sequence long before its end, especially since the rostral organ lacks mechanosensory receptors. Another good example from comparative neurobiology is the divergent development of the telencephalon in mammals and birds. Some early stages of telencephalic development are similar between the two lineages, but the later stages diverge dramatically. See Chapters 5 and 6. Thus, Neither of the two ontogenies recapitulates the other. Aside from refuting the idea that ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny, comparative analysis of developmental pathways can provide important insights into the mechanisms that are responsible for evolutionary change. Traditionally, biologists considered natural selection and changes in gene frequencies to be the principal mechanisms of evolution, but comparative developmental, that is, evo-devo, studies can provide an important complementary perspective by identifying the molecular and cellular mechanisms that account for species differences in development. For example, one study showed that experimental changes in the expression levels of specific genes can change the shape of a bird's beak in ways that mimic naturally occurring variation. Manipulating two genes at a time can even make the beak of a chicken look very much like the snout of its ancestors, the dinosaurs. Such work is difficult because evolutionary changes in development may have required coordinated changes in many different cellular and molecular processes, and because tracking characters across different developmental stages entails both technical and conceptual challenges. Nonetheless, further exploration of the evo-devo approach promises to provide a more complete synthetic understanding of the mechanisms that have driven evolutionary change. 1.2.5 Adaptation and Constraint. In addition to seeking the proximate or direct causes of evolutionary changes in biological characters, evolutionary biologists often aim to understand their distal or ultimate causes. Specifically, they seek to explain the reasons behind the evolutionary changes. Much work focuses on the benefits they might provide to individuals in terms of their survival and reproduction, although traits may also change for other non-adaptive reasons. The search for adaptive significance was, of course, Darwin's second profound contribution to biology. Although biologists generally assume that most biological characters provide some adaptive value, many also entail some costs. Therefore, most characters reflect some sort of compromise. In addition, some variants may be impossible for a species to generate, creating developmental or genomic constraints. In any case, the search for all such explanations usually begins with an examination of how the character in question co-varies with other body parts or processes, as well as the species' life history, behavior, and ecology. One common type of study examines how the size of a specific body part correlates with the size of the animal. Such studies frequently reveal that the body part does not scale proportionately with body size. That is, body parts tend to scale allometrically rather than isometrically. For example, the limb bones of an elephant are much thicker than those of small mammals, even after we account for their differences in length, figure 1.13. Indeed, across a wide range of tetrapods, limb bone diameter increases faster than limb bone length as one goes to larger and larger species. The ultimate explanation for this disproportionate increase in limb bone diameter is that, under isometric scaling, the limb bones would be too thin to carry the body's weight, which scales with the cube of its linear dimensions. One can call this a physical constraint, but it is probably the result of intense natural selection. Curiously, the exponent that describes how limb bone diameter scales with bone length does vary slightly between lineages. This variation probably reflects other adaptations and constraints that are at work in select lineages. Although scaling rules are commonly presented as universal scaling laws, evolution has often tweaked them. Other studies attempt to correlate specific features of a species with other variables, including habitat and behavior. In one such study, investigators examined how the shape of three different forelimb bones varies with the animal's mode of locomotion. The study was carried out in musteloid carnivores, for instance, weasels, otters, and raccoons, because their modes of locomotion vary widely, from fully aquatic to arboreal, figure 1.14. Bone shape was quantified rigorously, and the data were analyzed using principal component analysis. The major finding was that bone shape does indeed vary with locomotor mode, with the bones of the aquatic and semi-fossorial, that is, occasionally burrowing species, being more robust than those of the arboreal and semi-arboreal species. These findings are consistent with the idea that digging and swimming require strong muscles and bones, whereas climbing trees is easier with a light skeleton. Thus, the correlational data, combined with general biomechanical considerations, strongly suggest that the observed variations in bone shape were created by natural selection. A general issue with such correlational studies is that the species being compared cannot be treated as statistically independent data points, because they vary in their degree of phylogenetic relatedness, and one would expect closely related species to be quite similar in many traits. Consider, for example, the finding that herbivorous mammals tend to have smaller home ranges than carnivorous mammals. This correlation seems sensible, because carnivores tend to eat herbivores and, therefore, need to roam more widely to obtain their food. However, in one large data set showing the correlation between diet and home range size, all the herbivores were ungulates, for instance, horses, cows, whereas all the meat eaters were from the carnivore lineage. Thus, one can argue that the data set only contains two fully independent data points, one for each major lineage. Indeed, when the data were reanalyzed with statistical methods that correct for phylogenetic non-independence, the original correlation disappeared. This does not mean that the original hypothesis is false, just that the original data set could not be used to support it. In contrast, most of the aforementioned correlations between bone shape and locomotor mode in musteloids remained significant even after taking phylogeny into account. The principal reason for this difference is that the pattern of locomotor mode variation in musteloids, figure 1.14, implies a great deal of independent evolution, that is, convergence, which is not the case for the ungulate and carnivore data. The need to take phylogeny into account when conducting comparative correlational analyses has become widely appreciated, and a multitude of different statistical methods are now available. However, the approach does have limitations. For example, most of the statistical methods consider only evolutionary changes as potential evidence for adaptation, but a character's stability can also provide such evidence, since it may indicate that the character is under continued stabilizing selection. Moreover, different lineages might respond to similar selection pressures in different ways with different solutions. Such divergent responses would not be identified as evidence for adaptation in most correlational analyses. In general, the most serious problem with the correlational approach is that it cannot identify instances of adaptation that have occurred only once or a few times, which are precisely the sort of key innovations that occupy us in this book. In such instances, the correlational approach simply lacks statistical power. In short, the comparative correlational approach can provide statistically significant support for hypotheses of adaptation, but it cannot provide strong evidence against them. The way to overcome these limitations is to collect additional types of evidence. One may, for example, try to determine precisely when and where a particular character evolved, and then ask whether this coincides with changes in the environment that might have created novel selective pressures. One may also create biophysical models to show how the character might contribute to an individual's fitness. Even better, one can manipulate the character experimentally to see if this has the predicted effect. Ideally, such manipulations are carried out under natural conditions, so that their effects on survival and reproduction can be measured directly. For example, correlative studies had disagreed about whether the mating success of male peacocks covaries with the number of eye spots on their tail. But experimental removal of some eye spots reduced the mating success of the experimental males during the following mating season. Thus, the experimental approach bolstered the adaptive explanation for eye spots. A second, even more convincing example of the experimental approach tested the hypothesis that body coloration in male guppies represents a compromise between selection for being colorful in order to attract females and blending in with the environment to hide from predators. In one experiment, a population of guppies that had been exposed to high levels of predation was introduced into a stream that had few predators and no guppies. Within 2 years, the introduced guppies had become more colorful, thus supporting the adaptation hypothesis. In summary, it is generally difficult to explain the evolution of specific characters in terms of selective pressures and constraints, but converging lines of evidence can strengthen such efforts substantially. Indeed, evolutionary biologists have now assembled a large number of case studies that go well beyond the speculative just-so stories that used to plague the field. 1.3. Comparative approaches in neurobiology. Comparative studies of the nervous system should, in principle, be just like comparative research on other body parts and organ systems. However, the nervous system is far more complex than other organs, insofar as it contains an enormous number of cell types, a vast number of often highly specific connections between those cells, and molecular intricacies that surpass those observed in other parts of the body. Most importantly, the principles of how brains work remain much more mysterious than those for other morphological systems, especially if we consider not just mammalian brains, but brains in general. Compared to the principles of biomechanics that biologists can use to understand how bones and muscles work in diverse species, the principles of neuronal computation remain largely an unexplored frontier. For all of these reasons, comparative research on brains is challenging and relatively rare. Still, the field has made substantial progress since its early days. 1.3.1. Moving past the triune brain hypothesis. One of the most popular and influential ideas about brain evolution has been the triune brain hypothesis, which states that human brains consist of three major components that were acquired successively during phylogeny. Specifically, Paul MacLean began to propose in the 1960s that deep inside the human brain lies an essentially reptilian brain, his R-complex, which controls instinctive behaviors including feeding, fighting, fleeing, and reproduction. He further argued that all mammals added to this primitive brain an outer layer that comprises the limbic system, which includes the amygdala and hippocampus and endows mammals with an expanded capacity for prolonged parental care, love, and improved memory. The third component of MacLean's triune brain is the neocortex, which may have originated early in mammalian phylogeny, but was expanded greatly in the lineage leading to humans. It provides us with a supposedly unique capacity for rational thought. The most attractive aspect of MacLean's proposal was his suggestion that the three brains can sometimes be in conflict with one another. In this respect, MacLean's proposal is remarkably similar to Plato's ideas about the existence of three separate, sometimes conflicted souls. Sigmund Freud's concepts of id, ego, and superego also fit neatly into MacLean's tripartite model of inner conflict. Finally, MacLean's hypothesis probably benefited substantially from the support of Carl Sagan, who wrote a popular book on the subject. From a neuroanatomical perspective, the triune brain hypothesis never had strong support. Comparative neuroanatomists in the first half of the 20th century had argued that some parts of the forebrain and cerebellum were new with mammals, for instance, neocortex, but they already suspected that reptiles and other non-mammals possess homologs of the mammalian hippocampus and amygdala. As later chapters will explain, modern research has confirmed that the hippocampus and amygdala are not, as MacLean had claimed, mammalian innovations. Early 20th century neuroanatomists also thought that reptiles and birds and even sharks had at least a small general pallium or dorsal cortex that was probably homologous to the mammalian neocortex. These hypotheses were extended in the 1960s and 1970s, when comparative neuroanatomists used a variety of new techniques to reveal the detailed connectivity and histochemical organization of non-mammalian brains. Thus, the mammalian neocortex had deeper roots than MacLean had imagined. Over time, many comparative neuroanatomists came to believe that most features of mammalian brains have rather ancient roots, at least with regard to major brain divisions, such as the hippocampus or neocortex. The currently dominant paradigm holds that brain evolution does not add new components to old ones, as MacLean had argued, but modifies existing ones. We will argue in this book that this paradigm tends to mask some important innovations in brain structure and function. However, ours is a minority view, as the idea of evolutionary conservation, rather than innovation, drives the majority of current research in comparative neuroanatomy. The next two sections illustrate this point. 1.3.2 Evo-Devo and the New Neuromorphology. Extensive comparative studies of vertebrate brain development were conducted in the first half of the 20th century by Niels Holmgren, Harry Bergqvist, Bengt Collin, and others, who collectively may be referred to as the Swedish School of Comparative Neuroanatomy. One of their main insights was that across species, embryonic brains are more similar than adult brains. In particular, they focused on similarities at a very early stage, when embryonic brains consist mainly of a thin layer of dividing cells that surrounds a relatively large cerebral ventricle filled with cerebrospinal fluid. At this stage, which one might call the phylotypic period, the neural tube forms three or more less distinct bulges, which constitute the embryonic forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain. Crucially, the members of the Swedish school recognized that, during the phylotypic period, the neural progenitor cells are divisible into a patchwork of distinct proliferation zones, which are separated from one another by boundaries that exhibit reduced proliferative activity. Figure 1.16. Specifically, they identified a rostrocaudal series of transverse segments, which are called rhombomeres in the hindbrain, mesomeres in the midbrain, and prosomeres in the forebrain. Orthogonal to these segments are several longitudinal columns, such that the overall pattern resembles a checkerboard that was distorted by the developmental bending of the neural tube. Figure 1.16. Eventually, each proliferative zone gives rise to postmitotic cells, which then migrate away from the intracerebral ventricle and differentiate into distinct neuronal cell groups. Although the cells migrating away from different proliferative zones may intermingle, they tend to migrate mainly in the radial direction and, thus, remain largely segregated from one another. As the process of cellular differentiation proceeds, species differences tend to increase, which may then make it difficult to recognize homologies among adult cell groups across the major vertebrate lineages. According to the Swedish school, this problem can be solved by tracing the adult cell groups back to their developmental origins. As Collin wrote, "If it can be proved that two nuclei in different species develop from the same anlaga, precursor area, and in a similar way they must be looked upon as homologous. The longer the developments of two nuclei are similar, the stricter is the homology between the nuclei." As we review shortly, this idea lives on as field homology, but it was largely ignored at the time, especially by C.J. Herrick and his American School of Comparative Neuroanatomy. Herrick and his colleagues tended to ignore comparative embryological findings and focused instead on similarities in neural connections. Some American neuroanatomists did remain aware of what the Swedish school had found, but the development of new techniques for tracing neural connections in the 1960s and 1970s created a wealth of new data that encouraged connection-based homology hypotheses. Thus, interest in comparative neuroembryology waned in the second half of the 20th century. Fortunately, the insights of the Swedish school were rediscovered and extended when molecular biologists started mapping various gene expression patterns in early embryonic brains of diverse vertebrates. First came maps of various Hox genes, whose gene expression boundaries lined up remarkably well with the boundaries between the rhombomeres identified by the earlier researchers. These Hox genes are not expressed in more rostral brain regions, but the subsequent mapping of other transcription factors corroborated the existence of mesomeres and prosomeres, as well as many of the smaller subdivisions postulated by the Swedish school. Although the resulting neuromeric model of vertebrate brain organization has undergone several rounds of revision, it has provided an extremely useful framework for the synthesis of diverse gene expression data and the experimental analysis of brain patterning. It has, thus, helped to clarify the hierarchical organization of adult brain regions within a given species by showing how they are developmentally related to one another. Finally, it has proven to be widely applicable to a broad range of vertebrates. Thus, the comparative gene expression data have revived the fundamental tenet of the Swedish school, namely that early embryonic brains are divisible into multiple distinct progenitor zones that are broadly conserved across the vertebrates. With this notion at its core, a new neuromorphology is ascendant. 1.3.2.1 The Field Homology Concept. A second major tenet of the new neuromorphology is the concept of field homology, which Hobart Smith originally defined as derivation of structures, however similar or dissimilar, from the same ontogenetic source. This form of homology clearly echoes the views of Callan and the other members of the Swedish school, quoted earlier, but it deserves a special name, because field homologies tend to be invoked only when one-to-one homologies between adult structures cannot be found. Figure 1.17. For example, if the adults of one species have a greater number of deep cerebellar nuclei, see Chapter 6, than the adults of another species, strict homologies between those nuclei become difficult to draw. Even if one can homologize some of the nuclei between species, at least one nucleus would remain unaccounted for. Instead of having to argue that the extra nucleus was gained as a new feature in one of the species or lost in the other, one can use the field homology concept to sidestep the problem entirely. That is, if all of the adult cell groups under consideration can be traced back to a developmental precursor region that clearly is homologous between the species, then we can say that any of the adult nuclei in one species are field homologs of all the other nuclei in the other species. Thus, the concept of field homology permits homologies when more traditional, strict, homologies cannot be established. This benefit makes the field homology concept very attractive to seekers of homologies, but it has also been controversial. This is not the place to review these debates in depth, but a few points are worth making. First, we are troubled by the fact that invoking field homologies tends to obscure major innovations in adult form, which are our principal focus in this book. In essence, field homology substitutes embryonic homologies for adult non-homologies, relegating the latter to minor significance. Conservation is emphasized, the variation treated as noise. This one-sided focus on evolutionary conservation, or diversity denial, probably explains why the field homology concept is not used in systematics. As discussed in Section 1.2.2, phylogenetic systematists are keen to find novel characters that define monophyletic groups, that is, shared derived characters, but field homologies cannot be used in this way because they usually represent shared primitive characters, almost by definition. Although systematists may use ontogenetic data to support putative homologies, they are generally not interested in embryonic features that are conserved across all the species of interest. We, too, believe that the study of evolutionary conservation should be balanced with substantive analyses of variation. After all, Darwin referred to evolution as descent with modification.
Of course, and somewhat ironically, we recognize that a superb strategy for such investigations is to identify the developmental origins of adult structures that defy simple homologies. Comparing the relevant ontogenies across species can help us understand how phylogeny has modified ontogenies. Our second main concern with the field homology concept is that homologous adult characters may derive from non-homologous embryonic precursors, thereby putting field homology and more traditional homology hypotheses in conflict with one another. Indeed, multiple examples of evolutionary shifts in embryonic origin have been reported in the literature. For example, the gut develops from different, though overlapping, sets of embryonic tissues in sharks, lampreys, and amniotes. But few would argue that it is therefore not homologous across these lineages. It has been claimed that such evolutionary shifts in embryonic origins only occur before the phylotypic period and are, therefore, not a problem for the field homology concept as practiced by comparative neuroanatomists. However, this argument is weak, because the currently available comparative data on the developmental origins of adult brain regions rarely involve actual fate mapping experiments. We suspect, for example, that the motor neurons innervating the pectoral fins of fishes are homologous to the neurons innervating tetrapod limbs, but develop from different sets of neural tube segments. If this hypothesis were supported by fate mapping data, it would imply that these motor neurons are strict homologs, but not field homologs, unless one wants to claim that homologous precursor regions can arise from different body segments in different species. The latter claim is not as outlandish as it may seem at first, but it would raise a host of new questions. Our third note of caution is that current uses of the field homology concept are based on the assumption that the checkerboard parcellation of vertebrate brains during the phylotypic period, figure 1.16, is invariant across all vertebrates. Although our understanding of this conserved bauplan of vertebrate brains has evolved over the years, the underlying biological pattern is explicitly assumed to be constant across phylogeny. We are not yet convinced of this invariance. For example, the cerebellum is a genuine innovation of jawed vertebrates. See Chapter 3. Furthermore, some vertebrate lineages may have four distinct proliferative zones in their dorsal telencephalon, that is, four pallial divisions, whereas others have only three. See Chapters 3 and 7. Such a difference would imply a significant evolutionary change in the bauplan of select vertebrate brains and, thus, run counter to the paradigm of the new neuromorphology. Part of our argument is that the very idea of a bauplan for vertebrate brains implies that this bauplan is limited to vertebrates and therefore must have evolved from some other more ancient pattern. Some authors have countered that the bauplan for vertebrate brains is, in fact, applicable to all bilaterian animals, that is, all animals with bilateral symmetry. But we argue in Chapter 2 that this hypothesis is not well supported. Others may claim that what we identify as evolutionary novelties were latent in the ancestor, waiting only for some additional molecular interactions to reveal what had always been there. We think it is better to invert the perspective and ask instead how truly novel characters at one level of biological organization can evolve through novel interactions between lower-level elements. In short, we believe that even widely conserved, embryologically grounded patterns of brain organization can change, and almost certainly have changed, over evolutionary time. If this is true, then we cannot simply assume that the bauplan first identified in mammals and birds necessarily applies to other species. Empirical comparative studies are needed to demonstrate such conservation, as well as any variants. 1.3.3 Molecular and Cellular Homologies. Studies of nervous system evolution have traditionally focused on the phylogeny of entire brain regions, but recent research has shed increasing amounts of light on the phylogeny of neuronal cell types and molecules. Aside from adding substantially to our knowledge base, this work entails some interesting conceptual challenges, especially when it comes to integrating evolutionary changes across multiple levels of biological organization. 1.3.3.1 Gene and Protein Evolution. Research on the evolution of neurotransmitters, receptors, and other molecules integral to neuronal function has revealed a surprising degree of evolutionary conservation across the major vertebrate groups. Some of genes encoding these molecules even predate the origin of neurons. Despite this deep conservation, most genes involved in neuronal structure and function have changed substantially. For one thing, parts of chromosomes, and sometimes entire genomes, have duplicated one or more times in diverse lineages, creating complex gene families. Frequently, a subset of these duplicated genes has gained novel functions. Some genes appear to have no homologs in other lineages at all and are, therefore, considered new. Finally, even conserved genes often exhibit substantial variation in their protein coding region or regulatory sequences. Some of the molecular changes have occurred repeatedly in separate lineages, providing clear evidence for convergent evolution at the molecular level. This book does not deal with molecular evolution at length, but some important gene families, gene regulatory networks, and gene expression patterns are discussed in multiple chapters. For instance, figures 2.14, 2.20, 2.23, 2.25, 4.15, 6.12, 6.16, and 6.28. 1.3.3.2 Evolution of Cell Types. Biologists have traditionally defined cell types, both in the brain and in other parts of the body, on the basis of their structural and functional features. However, recent advances in molecular techniques have made it possible to examine the gene expression patterns of single cells, and this has sparked a movement to identify cell types in terms of the gene networks that are uniquely expressed in them. This shift has prompted some comparative biologists to argue that homologies between cell types in different species should be based on the conservation of an underlying gene regulatory signature or character identity network. A major benefit of this gene-based approach is that it allows cell types to be homologous regardless of how similar they are in terms of structure or function. This flexibility is important because the idea that characters can be homologous under every variety of form and function has been central to the concept of homology since its very inception. The gene-based approach also allows for homologous cell types to be located in different non-homologous parts of the body, of either the same species or different species, as long as homologous gene networks are activated in those cells. In essence, this approach uncouples evolutionary lineage from developmental lineage, which is important because some clearly homologous structures have long been known to develop from non-homologous precursor regions. See section 1.3.2. Finally, the gene-based approach makes it possible to reconstruct how cell types might have diversified during the course of evolution, with a single cell type giving rise to multiple sister cell types, much as single genes may duplicate during phylogeny. It is even possible for multiple cell types to fuse if their underlying gene networks become causally intertwined. Despite these advantages, the gene-based approach to cellular homologies entails some challenges. For one thing, cell types and gene networks are both hierarchically organized, which means that one must be careful to select the proper set of genes to identify a specific type of cell rather than some more general cell type. For example, one would not want to use a gene that is expressed in all neurons as evidence that two specific neuronal cell types are homologs of one another. In addition, identifying a set of genes that is co-expressed within a given cell is not the same as showing that these genes form an interacting network of genes. Indeed, Identifying and delimiting a gene regulatory network requires extensive experimental evidence, which is, at best, only available for a subset of the species of interest. Particularly troublesome is the idea that gene networks themselves may change during the course of evolution, potentially losing some components or co-opting others. Therefore, establishing homologies between cell-type-specific gene networks is not as simple as it may at first appear. Although the issues surrounding cell-type homologies are general, they are especially acute for neuronal cell types, because neurons tend to be structurally complex and extremely diverse. Traditionally, the identification of potentially homologous neurons has been based on similarities in cell size, dendritic architecture, and axonal connections. Figure 1.18. But similarities in gene expression profiles have recently been used to support a few neuronal homology hypotheses. These efforts have been especially successful in tracing the phylogeny of relatively ancient cell types, such as photoreceptors. Molecular data have also been used to support cellular homologies in the telencephalon of various amniotes. But it remains unclear whether the genes in this analysis actually form a coherent network that was retained from a common ancestor. Thus, it remains possible that some of the observed similarities are due to convergent evolution rather than homology. Ultimately, this possibility can be excluded only by broad taxonomic sampling and the kind of parsimony analysis described in Section 1.2.3. Another area of concern is that, in our view, comparative neurobiologists tend to underappreciate the possibility that homologous neurons may develop in non-homologous brain regions. When homologous neuron types are found in non-homologous brain regions, neurobiologists tend to assume that those neurons were born in homologous precursor regions and only later migrated into different, non-homologous brain regions. This does happen sometimes, especially among neurons that tend to migrate far. However, as noted at the beginning of this section, the gene-based view of cellular homologies explicitly allows homologous cell types to develop in non-homologous tissues, as long as their differentiation involves the activation of homologous gene networks. This phylogenetic uncoupling between neuronal cell types and brain regions becomes a serious problem when one attempts to base hypotheses of brain region homology on the homology of their constituent neurons. Of course, one may counter that it is difficult to imagine how one could homologize two or more brain regions without referring to the attributes of the neurons that they contain. We address this conundrum by recognizing explicitly that evolution at the molecular, cellular, and regional levels may proceed independently of one another, at least to some extent. This lack of one-to-one correspondence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.